Good morning. Welcome to worship. Good to have you here today. I want to say a word of welcome to those who are worshiping with us via live stream. Glad you can be with us in that capacity. Again, if you live here in town, if you have opportunity, we'd certainly want to encourage you to try and make it back to church sometime. Always welcome to be back worshiping with us here in the sanctuary. But I want to take a moment to also welcome those who are new to us today, a visitor, to bring a family member or friend that you'd like to introduce. I think we got a gentleman from over here from northern Minnesota today. Northern Minnesota. Yep. Tell us your name again.
Mark.
Mark. Sounds like a good Minnesota name, right? Yeah. Mark. Biblical, too. All right, up near Tower, Minnesota, way up there. Yep, up there. Anybody else that's new to us today that want to say hi? Yeah, way in the back. You're from Buffalo, Minnesota. All right, very good. That's just out west of Minneapolis a little bit. Yes.
We have our sister-in-law here from Fargo, North Dakota.
All right. We got the Minnesota, North Dakota representation today. Hi. Yeah.
Susan from Reno, Nevada, Good Shepherd Lutheran Church.
All right. Very good. Good Shepherd Lutheran Church in Reno, Nevada. Very good. Hi.
We have our son here from Ketchikan, Alaska, and his wife, Rebecca, and her two children, Lexi and Lane.
Great. Very good. So have you had a lot of snow up there this year? Oh, because I know that there are certain parts of Alaska that are just getting hammered this year. Oh, I see. I got a friend that lives in Alaska, and she is like snow beyond. She's like, I'm so sick of snow. She said, it's just like, it's every other day they're shoveling and blowing snow. So, others that are new to us today. All right, let's take a moment and welcome our guests. Also want to encourage you to fill out the friendship registry and pass it on down. A few things I want to bring to your attention today. Later on this morning, after the 10 o'clock service, go home. It's not too late. Get that favorite dish that you want to prepare and come back and be a part of our international St. Patrick's Day international potluck. So we're going to be gathering here in the Friendship Cafe here after the 10 o'clock hour, and so it's not too late, and even if you have to run out to the grocery store and grab something and bring it down, we'd love to have you come back and be a part of our international St. Patrick's Day potluck. And speaking of which, happy St. Patrick's Day. Although I did err on the side of not mentioning that there's, what's the saint from
Urho,
yes. Yesterday was St. Urho Day. So I had some of my Finnish friends here that were kind of upset that I didn't mention St. Urho Day. So anyway, my apologies to all my Finnish people out there if you're listening in. Also, next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and so if you have some fresh palm fronds, we are going to be receiving those next Saturday between 9 and 10 right out here next to the columbarium. So if you could bring those by, it would very much be appreciated. Also, next weekend is the wood shop sale, all weekend long, Saturday and Sunday. Are they meeting on Friday too? No, I think it's just Saturday and Sunday. But again, the wood shop folks have been crazy, crazy busy doing all kinds of projects this year, and they've got tons and tons of things to make available to you. So if you'd like to stop by, and all the wonderful thing about all of the money that's raised from the spring sale is that the wood shop puts a lot of that money back into the community. So you know, whatever money they raise, a very significant portion of that goes to a lot of different mission things. One of the things that I know the wood shop's sale supports is they support the TEL wheelchair ministry over in Thailand, along with many other things. So it's money that goes towards a very good cause. Also, just wanted to give you an update that we were notified by the florist that our altar flowers have been going up, or they're going to be going up in price to $45. It's been $35 now for probably well over 10 years. So it's, you know, it's not like it's out of line for them to ask for a few extra dollars for altar flowers, because, you know, it's called inflation, right? So $45 from here on out. For those of you who have already made a gift towards flowers for coming weekends, if you would like to entertain the idea of throwing in an extra $10, that would be fantastic. So just consider that. But that's, we just want to make sure that you're aware that when you start signing up for flowers, it'll be $45 from here on out. Also, we're going to be blessed today with Anne, who's here to bring a music offering, and you will be greatly blessed. She sang last night, and it was just a marvelous piece. So thank you, Anne. Appreciate it. What's that? I just raised the bar. No. No need to raise the bar with Anne. She has a naturally beautiful voice. Also, this coming Tuesday night, for those of you who would like to participate or be a member at large at our church council meeting, which I know there's so many of you that just want to come out on Tuesday night for a council meeting. I mean, it's just, the place is just packed with people, overwhelming packed with people who want to be there for council meetings. Actually, that's not even close to true. But we do have a few faithful, but this coming Tuesday, rather than meeting in the Lakeview room, we're going to be meeting back here in the music room. So if you do want to come, you have to access coming around this side of the building, behind by the van, and come around the back side. It's the first door on your right, the music room. Other than that, please read the remaining announcements there for yourself and find ways to participate in the ongoing work and ministry here at Mount Olive. Our call to worship. Invite you to stand as you are able. During this season of Lent, we're called to return to the Lord with all our heart. Let us confess our sin and seek reconciliation with God and neighbor. Holy God, we confess to you our faults and failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurt, though you call us to heal. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us as we seek to follow in your way of life. Amen. Hear the good news. God so loved the world that God gave his only Son, that all may receive life. This promise is for all of us. And God embraces us with divine mercy and forgives us in Christ's name and revives us in the Spirit's power. Amen. Our opening hymn, Come Thou Almighty King. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Please join me now in the prayer of the day. O God, with steadfast love, you draw us to yourself. And in mercy, you receive our prayers. Strengthen us to bring forth the fruits of the Spirit, that through life and death we may live in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our reading is from Jeremiah, chapter 31. The Judeans in Babylon blamed their exile on their ancestors who had broken the covenant established at Sinai. Here the prophet looks to a day when God will make a new covenant with the people. There will be no need to teach the law because God will write it on their hearts. Hear now God's word of hope for his people. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judea. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I'll write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, "Know the Lord," for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord.
There are places I remember all my life, though some have changed, some forever, not for better, some are gone, and some remain. All these places Mount Olive Church. I know I'll often stop and think about them, but in my life I loved you more. Soon we'll come to the journey, and perhaps
Our second reading is from Hebrews chapter 5. Using priestly imagery and references to the Old Testament, the author explains how Christ lived in trusting obedience to God, and so God has made Christ the source of our eternal salvation. Hear now God's word of hope for his people. Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel is from the 12th chapter of John. Glory to you, O Lord. Now there were some Greeks amongst those who went up to worship at the feast, and they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. "Sir," they said, "we would like to see Jesus." And Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip in turn told Jesus. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. The man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my heart is troubled. What shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this very reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." And then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified you and will glorify you again." And the crowd that was there heard it and said it had been thunder, or others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, "The voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. But I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to show the kind of death that he was going to die. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Invite you to pray with me in invoking and inviting the Holy Spirit into our meditation today. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill the hearts of your faithful. Kindle in us the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and we shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. O God, who by the light of the Holy Spirit instructs the hearts of the faithful, grant that by that same Holy Spirit we may be made truly wise and ever rejoice in his consolations. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. This is another one of those gospel texts this week that has a variety of things happening and many, many things that Jesus said that are not necessarily easy words to hear. And of course, as a pastor, I have to kind of discern where it is that the Spirit's leading, what message needs to perhaps be heard this week. And so this is where the Spirit's leading me. I suppose you could say that from a chronological order of things in Jesus' life and the the things that occurred during his ministry, that we would have to say that we're a little bit offline. Because next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and that'll be the time when we hear the story of Jesus entering into Jerusalem. And yet this passage that's before us today is actually a passage that is immediately following Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem. So we're a little bit of ahead of schedule in a certain sense. I'm not the one who makes up the lectionary series, so in their divine wisdom, whoever those people are that decide what passages are to be shared each week, this particular passage seems to be a little bit out of order. We're obviously in the 12th chapter of the Gospel of John. Now, if you look back in the 11th chapter of John, we just heard that Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. And of course, raising a person from the dead obviously caused quite a buzz amongst a lot of people. And because of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead, a lot of curiosity, the curiosity level about Jesus was building. And the words were spreading about his miracles. It even says in the 12th chapter of John, in verses 17 and 18, it says that the crowd that was with him, when he raised Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead, continued to spread the word. And many people began, because they heard that he had given this miraculous sign, many people went out to meet him. And this is where our passage picks up today. But just prior to this passage, it also says that the scribes and the Pharisees and the chief priests, they were growing more and more concerned about Jesus, and they were continuing their plot to kill him. So here we are. This is the context in which we find ourselves today. This curiosity about Jesus was expanding, so much so that even some Greeks, those who were considered not of the Jewish faith or practice, they were coming to see and to hear more about Jesus. It says that they approached Philip. "Sir, we would like to see Jesus." Now, translations, I looked at a variety of different translations of that actual phrase. And for the most part, that translation of that phrase is either "we wish" or "we want" or "we would like to see Jesus." We wish, we want, or we would like to see Jesus. How many times have you found yourself asking yourself or saying that statement? How many times in your life have you heard yourself saying, "I want to see Jesus. I wish I could see Jesus." I think that's something that all of us do at a variety of different times and different contexts in our life. One of the things that we don't know in this story is that this is one of those things that continues to frustrate me and perhaps maybe some of you, is that this is another one of those times when we really don't know what the rest of the story is, because we really don't know whether or not these Greeks actually did ever see Jesus, at least physically, or actually face to face. It doesn't actually tell us whether or not they actually had the opportunity to see Jesus face to face and actually talk to him, because that's not included in our gospel. "I want to see Jesus. We want to see Jesus. We would like to see Jesus." 3 years ago, I told you about a Dr. Reverend Vernon McGee. He was a pastor at the Church of the Open Door in downtown Los Angeles many years ago. And on his pulpit was a plaque with the words, and it was for only him to see. It was placed across the top of his pulpit. There were the words that were inscribed, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." And it was put there by Dr. McGee to remind him that every time that he would have opportunity to speak, that somehow people would come to see Jesus. That he saw himself as simply being the messenger. But through his preaching, it was his prayer that people would somehow see and experience Jesus. Maybe you're getting tired of it, maybe you're not, but one of the reasons why I have take this opportunity to precede each meditation and each sermon with the Holy Spirit prayer is to acknowledge that it is actually the Holy Spirit that makes it possible for you and for me to see or to perceive Jesus in the message that's being given. And so we, every Sunday, we pray, "Come, Holy Spirit." One of the other prayers that I have found helpful to pray at various times in my life are these words. "I believe, Lord, that you are present. Although my eyes do not see you, my faith senses you. Take any stray thoughts from my mind and make me understand the truths which you wish to teach me in this meditation. Let me make up my mind to put them into practice. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Speak, Lord, to my soul." This is another prayer that's been around for a long, long time. It's been prayed in a multitude of different settings, and in retreats, and in sermons, in temples, and in large sanctuaries. A universal prayer that's been prayed by many, many a pastor. We want to see Jesus. One of the privileges that I have in my pastoral call is to have the privilege of having honest, hard, and sometimes painful conversations with people concerning their situations and circumstances in their lives. And I know that perhaps some of those conversations have been with you. And every one of you here comes from a different place and a different context. Every one of you has your own unique place and context in life. And preaching to a multitude of contexts, to say the least, is difficult and challenging. And that's why, for me, I have to continually trust in the discernment of the Holy Spirit. This week was not unlike many weeks that I have. But this week in particular, I heard a lot of voices from various people in my conversations. People who, in one way, shape, or form, who are at a crossroads in their life, who are at an intersection in their faith where they're on a path right now, where they are finding it hard to see or to discern Jesus. Perhaps you found yourself in that place in your life at some time. We all have. If we're really honest with ourselves, we have all found ourselves in that place in our life of faith where we have been on a path where we have been finding it hard to see or discern Jesus. Now, I can't go into any of the specifics about their life circumstances, but I know from my conversations that seeing Jesus or discerning Jesus' presence is very much the place where these people find themselves right now. And I know that they are struggling with wanting to see Jesus in their life. And this has caused me this week to do a little thinking back and reflecting a little bit on my own life. I was thinking about, especially after confirmation class on Wednesday night. One of the things that I find that I need to do when I'm teaching confirmation class is I have to think back. I have to always be thinking back to what it was like for me when I was in confirmation. Where was I at in my faith? Where was I at in my understanding of Jesus? Did I even have any idea of who Jesus was? Or was even that Jesus was even a part of my life? Was that even on my radar screen? Did I even have the slightest idea of what it meant to even pray the prayer, "Come, Lord Jesus"? You know, that prayer that our parents taught us to faithfully pray before our meals, "Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest." Did I even have the slightest idea what that meant to pray that? Or for that matter, did I even have the slightest idea what it really meant to pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven"? In a certain sense, what we're saying there is, "Come, Lord, and be present. Come so that I can see you in this world." And I say that partially out of my own perception of where I see these confirmands that I'm working with right now in their life. Because there are things about being a young person that are really hard. I think it's probably even harder now to be a young person than it was when I was growing up. And I think it's even harder for young people to even be thinking about and asking the question, "Where do I see Jesus?" Because it's not something that's even remotely on their radar screen most of the time. And it's really hard to see Jesus in a world in which there are the pressures, the bullying, the name-calling, the social media posts, and all the teasing that bombards their lives. And that is the reality of a lot of our young people these days. And on top of all that, they may or they may not even be questioning or discerning who Jesus is for them. And so for me, as I think about my work with these young people in confirmation class, that I need to continually trust in the prodding and the discernment and the guidance of the Holy Spirit in their lives. And I know from my own experience that they will, at some point in their life, gradually come into a greater understanding and have an aha moment, perhaps, where they actually do experience Jesus in a very significant way. So as I stand before you today, I'm thinking about our youth, and I'm also thinking about those people that I had conversations with this past week who are finding it hard to see Jesus right now, or who may not even be looking to see Jesus. But one of the things that I hear in this gospel passage today is that I hear Jesus speaking a word of promise. In his foretelling of his death, he is giving us a promise. He says, "The prince of this world will be driven out, and when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself." The prince of this world will be driven out, and when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself. That is a word for all of us. That is a promise to all of us. It's a promise to every person on the earth, that every person on the earth has this opportunity to be drawn to Jesus. That doesn't mean that everybody will be, but everybody does have the opportunity to be drawn to Jesus. And Jesus is continually and constantly drawing us to Him. And that even in the midst of some of those wavering moments when it's really hard to see Jesus and we wonder where Jesus is, in the midst of our questioning, in the midst of our unsteadiness, the words of Jesus are still calling out to us, and the words are drawing us and gathering all people to Him, drawing us to see and experience a love that only Jesus is able to give us. And where is it that we see that love? We see it at the cross. We are drawn to the cross where God's love is poured out. I've shared this with you before, but I'm going to share it with you again. Back in the day when I was a part of a group of ecumenical youth back in high school, we used to travel around and do worship services in a variety of different churches in rural South Dakota. And one of the songs that we would sing during our worship services was the song, "Have You Seen Jesus, My Lord?" Have you seen Jesus, my Lord? He's here in plain view. Well, one of the verses says, "Have you seen Jesus, my Lord?" And it says, have you ever looked at a cross and seen a man hanging in pain? Seen the look of love in his eyes? Then I say, you've seen Jesus, my Lord. I believe that we can take solace and have great comfort in knowing that Jesus is absolutely relentless and that His love for us is constant. Jesus is the one who gathers all people to Himself. Last week I said at the foot of the cross, God's love for the world is abundantly present there. And there is something about that image. There is something about that image. Have you seen Jesus, my Lord? A man hanging in pain with a look of love in your eyes. There's something about that image of God's love being abundantly present at the foot of the cross that keeps encouraging me, that keeps motivating me, and keeps giving me a hope in the midst of despair, that gives me wholeness in the midst of brokenness. And that even in times in my life when I'm unsteady and uncertain, Jesus is the one who is steady. In the times of my life when I myself am unloving or find it hard to love, Jesus continues to keep on loving me, whether I love or not. And so may this be our prayer. Come, Holy Spirit, and help us each day to see Jesus, to experience His love, His grace, and His mercy in our lives. Help us and encourage us to realize that Jesus' love and His pursuit of us is relentless, that You are constant and constantly and steadily drawing us to Yourself. And remind us that Your love for the world is abundantly present at the foot of the cross. Amen. We're going to sing "Beneath the Cross of Jesus." I invite you to stand.
Please join with me now in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and a world in need. God of the covenant, through the church you draw us into community. We give thanks for the means of grace around which we gather. Inspire writers, musicians, and artists whose creative gifts adorn our worship. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all that exists, you lavish the earth with extravagant beauty. Preserve the rich and complex diversity of living things. Support local, national, and international efforts to protect the environment for future generations. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of the nations, you desire peace and plenty for all people. Defend those who challenge oppression and expose corruption. Support advocates for human rights, social justice, and the welfare of children. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of goodwill, you restore what is broken. We pray for any experiencing estrangement, conflict, or abuse in families and intimate relationships. Protect and comfort all who are vulnerable, especially those living in institutions. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of every time and place, you are with us. Support ministries of prayer and presence in this congregation. Move us to reach out to any who are homebound, lonely, grieving, who are in treatment, or who are ill. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of promise, give thanks for the saints whose faith inspire us, especially Patrick, missionary to Ireland, whom we commemorate today. Grant us faith to trust in your everlasting love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Accompany us on our journey, Lord God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's take a moment to extend the peace. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, in mercy for our fallen world. You gave your only Son, that those who believe in him should not perish but have eternal life. And we give you thanks for the salvation that you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in this Holy Supper. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. It was on the night in which he was betrayed that our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks. He blessed it. He broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks. He gave it for all to drink, saying, This cup is a new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Please join me now as we pray the prayer our Lord has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Remembering then his death and resurrection, we lift this bread and cup before you, giving you thanks that you have made us worthy to stand before you and to serve you as your priestly people. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to establish our faith in truth, that we may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. I call upon those who are going to be assisting with communion today to come forth and prepare the altar as well. For those of you who are communing with us at home, we offer up to you these words of grace with the means of grace. This is the body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Also, for those of you who are communing today, we do have a gluten-free bread wafer that you can request. Just simply indicate that at the time that you come. Also, if you're going to receive grape juice, please indicate that you'd like to receive grape juice by just simply raising your finger, and that would give the communicants, the people who are serving, the opportunity to... Oh, so we do have enough. I didn't know we had two assigned. So come on up, Candy. I only saw one name in the bulletin, so I decided to go try and ask somebody else, and somebody else had already taken care of that. All right, all is prepared.
Thank you.
now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Amen. Please join me now with a post-communion prayer. God, our Redeemer, you have fed us at this table with gifts of grace, truth, and life. As you have gathered us in joy, send us forth as messengers of your peace. Make us shine with good news of your glory, born to us in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
And now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Our ascending hymn, Rise, Shine, You People.
Go in peace and tell what God has done. Thanks be to God.